Thank you so much for joining us this morning. We were away in June, and when we came back, we also had some friends visiting from South Africa, so June was a good time away for us, and an exciting time of having some friends from South Africa here and showing them around in this beautiful area that we live in. But it's good to be with you all this morning. And I'm really excited and expectant for the word this morning. So, to start off, I want you to close your eyes. Close your eyes for a moment. And think of the one thing you are longing for most in this season of your life. And be very honest. That one thing you long, you crave for, you wish for the most in the season. And I want to ask you, you can open up your eyes again. We're starting off deep this morning. And we will be going deeper. Is your soul satisfied? Is your soul satisfied? And will that, if you were honest with that thing that you are longing for, that thing, will that thing satisfy your soul? There are a few things in life that I really love. I'm passionate about it. From a young age, I've loved water. I love the ocean. I love riding waves. It's something that I can talk about for quite some time. It's always an exhilarating experience for me. Listening to music since I was a young boy and later on making my own music, it's a passion of mine. It's something that I enjoy so much. It's when I was still single, writing some singles, I could spend hours and hours just playing guitar. And recently I've taken up woodworking. And it's something also that I can be outside, I can work for 6 hours nonstop and not realize it's been 6 hours. Maybe for you it was something else that you are longing for this morning, or something else that really you get excited about. Maybe you're longing for another job, maybe you're longing for a vacation, maybe you are longing for a new car, maybe you're longing for a spouse. Do I truly believe that Jesus can satisfy my soul? And these are questions I'm asking myself as well. If I don't believe that, what am I missing? We started off this year with a sermon series where we just journeyed through John 14, verse 6. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Do we long for that life this morning? C.S. Lewis has a quote that I love. I think it's from Mere Christianity, his book. If we find ourselves, I don't know if when I read this the first time, I could so relate to it. Because I can go surfing and there's always that one wave that I haven't caught. Or I can write a song and when I was still in the band with my friends, we can have this performance. But there was always this one or two places in a song where we didn't nail it, and there's always just this something more that I would be longing for. If we find ourselves with the desire that nothing in this world can satisfy, the most probable explanation is that we were made for another world. Anyone that can relate with that? And there he's not talking about Narnia, he's talking about heaven, life with God. Last weekend, during intercession before church, just a quick reminder, church actually starts at 8:15 in intercession. All of you are welcome. I really want to invite you at some time just to come and join. It's always such a privilege to hear what God is saying to us together And like Donnie always says, you know, you might be spending your own quiet time at home, and you might hear things and you think, oh, I'm imagining myself. And you come to church and you hear other people are praying the exact things that you were hearing. It's awesome. Anyway, last weekend during intercession, I really just experienced this urgency, and I saw a picture, and you can put up that picture there. And I had this picture of us being in a barren desert, and it's like we are so desperate, and we're drilling for water, and you're drilling for water, and you can't see anything on the surface until you hit an aquifer. So an aquifer is a water store deep beneath the earth's hardened surface, which when is struck, all of a sudden, it obviously depends on that specific water source's pressure, but it starts pushing up by itself. It gushes out by itself. And I mean, look, that picture on your right doesn't look like a typical place to go and drill for water, right? It looks like our backyard, yeah. And in that picture, I'm just reminded of Psalm 42, where it talks about the deep that calls out to deep. And the hard surface, I felt, the hard surface that needs to be drilled through is our hearts. And the drill is God's word. And the water that needs to start gushing out afresh is the Spirit of God. What do we see on the body surface? On the busy surface, what do we see on the busy surface of your life today? And what actually lies deep down, crying out from within? John 7, verse 37 to 39. On the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood up and cried out, saying, If anyone, not some select, elect, elite, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. Revelation 22 and 21 also talks about this water of life that God freely gives. Let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, that's a key word this morning as well. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. Out of his heart, I'm talking about that drill and the depths of our heart and that water that needs to come out. Out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. But this he spoke concerning the Spirit whom those believing in him would receive. Often the Holy Spirit, there are a few symbols of the Holy Spirit throughout Scripture, but one of those symbols is water. And that brings me to the title and an invitation to all of us this morning. The title of my message is an invitation. All who are thirsty. All who are thirsty. And I just want to pray for us this morning. Father, this morning we come by faith and not by sight. Just as that one picture, Lord God, showed a man standing in the middle of the desert. This morning, maybe, Lord God, where we are at in the season in our lives, Lord God, all the things going on in the busy surface of our lives, Lord God. Maybe the barrenness, the drought that we are experiencing, Lord God. We do not come merely to look at that. We come by faith this morning, Lord God. And I just pray this word, this scripture over us this morning. I come and thank you for your word that is living, that is powerful, and that is sharper than any two-edged sword, Lord God, dividing between spirit and soul, marrow and bone, sifting and analyzing the thoughts and the intents of our hearts. Lord, we come and trust that your word will drill into the depths of our hearts this morning, that we might see a fresh, Lord God, outflowing of your Holy Spirit in our lives, Lord God. And I pray this morning that you come and quench, Lord God, the thirst within, Lord God, the thirst within that you and you alone are not only able but also willing to quench and satisfy this morning. I pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. So another thing that we've been praying on and discerning on Tuesday mornings and on Sunday mornings is that we sort of sense that there's a degree of a spiritual fatigue and a spiritual slumber, and we are only halfway through the year. It's usually, last year was the first time I heard about Octoberitis, where everyone is sort of, you're just so tired, you don't have any energy left to another thing to do. And it's something that we're discerning in the spirit, and we're only halfway through the year. And maybe for some of us, when we closed our eyes this morning, we were longing for a vacation or a holiday. But those aren't always the solution. For myself, I just recently experienced that again in a very real way. I've been working from January straight, and with us working after hours and weekends, I've learned for myself, it's ideal for me once every 3 to 4 months at least to take a break. So it was a full 6 months pushing through and quite a lot of stress. Some of you know, we've been applying for a work permit again, and things were unsure. Literally when I left, I didn't have a clear answer yet, whether when I come back, if I can stay here and continue to work. So it was a stressful time, and I was just like, you know what, I'm going to forget about everything. I'm just going to go on holiday. We're going to go have a good family time. We're going to be in the veld and everything. And you know, and I was banking everything on this holiday. And that didn't fix the fatigue. It didn't fix, you know, the dry spiritual state that I was in a way. And interestingly, as I came back, I read this statistic that around 50% of tired people who go on holiday experience full-on burnout within the first few weeks after coming back from that vacation. It's because we live lives in a way that we never rest, and that's a whole sermon on its own. And then we go on holiday and vacation and think, okay, in this 7, 10, 14 days, I'm just going to have a reboot. That's not the way it works. So if we're tired or overwhelmed, why so? And there can be many reasons. Sometimes we need to learn some disciplines of working in rest in our weekly rhythms. But maybe sometimes there's something spiritual as well. John 4, verse 10 to 14, it's Jesus sitting with the woman at the well. And Jesus answered and said to her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. You'll see already by now, that's a strong theme this morning. Living water. The woman said to him, sir, you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Jesus answered and said to her, and this has struck me quite a few times in my life, whoever drinks of this water will thirst again, but whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. Whoever drinks of the water that I will give will never thirst, but the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. This echoes those words from John 7. I've asked myself this question a few times in life. If I find myself thirsty, what wells am I drinking from? And we're going to dive or work through quite a bit of scripture today, looking at what could be some of these reasons that we run dry in a spiritual sense. God longs for our hearts. He longs for your heart. We're journeying through Hebrews 3, a number of verses from Hebrews 3. Therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Do not harden your hearts. That hard surface that the drill, the Word of God needs to get through. to get to those water sources, that the Holy Spirit might flow through our lives. Today, if you will hear His voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. Maybe there's something in your heart this morning that you're just kicking against the goads. You're just resisting the Lord. Why? Therefore, I was angry with that generation and said, they always go astray in their heart. We're going to be looking quite a bit at our hearts this morning. Why are we going astray in our hearts? And they have not known my way. So I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. We're talking about a spiritual fatigue. They shall not enter my rest. Beware, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief. We're going to be looking at belief this morning. In departing from the living God, but exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you should be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. Maybe there's a sin in your life that you are just indulging in, or maybe you are hating it because of how it is hardening your heart. Bring it to God. Or maybe this morning you've lost any hunger or thirst for the Lord because sin has brought that deceit in your life where you just don't care anymore. Bring that deceit to the Lord. So we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief. What is hardening your heart today that keeps the Word of God at the distance? Keeping it from allowing it to take root that bears fruit in your life. Allowing it to mold you, to wash you. God longs for your heart. Now things that often, we've seen a few things here in Hebrews 3 that can take hold of our hearts, but two simple things that I want to highlight this morning that can harden our hearts or take hold of our hearts. The one is idols, and the other one is veils. James 4, verse 4 to 5. Adulterers and adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. And the Amplified Version expresses verse 5 so beautifully, and this is where I was just reminded how God really longs for our hearts. Or do you suppose that the Scripture is speaking to no purpose that says, the Spirit whom He has caused to dwell in us? Remember Hebrews 7, from our innermost being, God wants the Holy Spirit to well up. The Spirit whom He has caused to dwell in us yearns over us, craves possession, longs after. And He yearns for the Spirit to be welcomed with a jealous love. God is jealous for your heart. He yearns for your heart. He craves to have possession of our hearts. But what idols are distracting or defining our hearts today? Is it our problems? Is it our profession? Or is it our play? Our hobbies, the things we spend our spare time and money on. We know our Scripture says what our hearts are full of, our mouths run over with. So if you're in small group, what are you talking about all the time? Are you, every time or in any conversation, are you always talking about that specific problem, or always talking about what's going on in your job, your profession, or are we always only talking about play? If I'm only always talking to you about surfing, then I must maybe ask myself one or two questions. What idols are distracting or defining our hearts? We're talking about our hearts. God longs for our heart, but He has also given us the choice on how we will live with our hearts and how we will surrender our hearts to Him. What do we treasure and guard most? Matthew 6, verse 19-21. Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be. So it's that thing that we are thinking about, talking about most of the time, pursuing most of the time. Our hearts is going to follow that. Where our treasure is, there our heart will be also. And this is the invitation that maybe for some of us it's a warning this morning, or for some of us maybe just a reminder. Proverbs 4 verse 23, keep and guard your heart. Keep and guard your heart from those things that's maybe hardening your heart or deceiving your heart. Keep and guard your heart with all vigilance and above all that you guard. For out of it flows, here we see that again, out of it flows the springs of life. The New Living Translation says it even in this more straight way. It determines the course of your life. How we guard our hearts, there where we put our treasures, it will determine the course of our life. We're talking about idols. Idols is when, in a simple way, someone else, in a very simple way, someone else is on the throne, or something else is on the throne of your heart. I'm always convicted by that song that we sometimes sing, may we never lose our wonder. And I realized going into the holiday, I was so caught up with the stress of these work permits, and I was so looking forward to everything that we're going to do on the holiday, and you get to this place where you think, I'm okay because I'm serving at church, I'm preaching, I'm in the worship band, I do that, and you think spiritually you're okay because of all of those things that you do. But what does it help if along the way we lose our wonder? And I was just reminded of this scripture this morning, as I was preparing, Matthew 13 verse 44-46, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and hid, and for the joy over it, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. I just think about that guy's passion. He's like, he's found this stash of treasure, and he would sell everything to obtain that treasure in that land. That passion, that wonder that he had. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking beautiful pearls. He, when he had found one pearl of great price, went and sold all he had and bought it. Is that the kind of wonder and passion and conviction and determination that we live with regards to the things of God's kingdom? And just a quick break. We are a family. And as we are talking about pearls and jewels, we just want to say a big congratulations to Julian and Bianca. This guy's blushing very much. But they got engaged during this last week. I think it was last weekend, right? We are very excited. We've been watching you. We've been waiting. We just want to say, well done, Julian. It always starts with the man taking the initiative, so well done. And Bianca, thank you very much for saying yes. But we're really excited with you guys, and we really just pray God's favor and blessing. We're so excited to see what the Lord is doing in your life, even before this time, but also looking forward with a great expectation of what the good work that he's going to continue to complete in your lives. Amen. So I'm just checking if everyone's still with me. Okay? I mean, when you are planning the purchase of that diamond, it's a pretty diamond. I checked it this morning. But when he was preparing, so much planning went into that, so much determination went into that, whether it was saving, whether it was doing research, whether it was understanding what Bianca specifically was, whether it was driving or going to visit parents, everything went into winning her heart, getting that yes, and obtaining that treasure. It's more than just the ring, obviously the lady of his dreams, but if we talk about the kingdom, how are we planning our weeks in the practical? It's a practical thing. He did a few very practical things. And that's how it is with us pursuing God as well. It takes practical things to say that I truly value you. Bianca, I value you. God, I value you. These people, they were seeking and then they found this pearl, they found this treasure, and then they started making plans. For me, it's always a big thing in my life. I don't want my faith to be philosophical. I want it to be practical and real. Amen? May we not lose our wonder, because idols will never satisfy. Remember that question I asked in the beginning? Maybe you were just longing for more time with the Lord. Praise God, you're at an awesome place in your life. But maybe some of us were longing for some other things. The only thing that will ever satisfy us is to seek the kingdom. And the kingdom is where God reigns. And Romans 14:17 has this beautiful promise, along with Matthew 6:33. I'll read both of them. For the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking. We need those things. There's nothing wrong to long for a vacation or a new car or a spouse. There's nothing wrong with longing for those natural things. But we were made for more. We were made for more. Remember that quote right in the beginning of C.S. Lewis? If nothing in this world satisfies us, it means we were meant for another world. It means that there's something in us that longs for more. For the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking, but righteousness. That means being in right standing, in the right place with God. Peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. I sometimes simplify life to these things, that what do we want most really at the bottom of anything that we long for, whether a vacation, whether a diamond. We long for peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. A friend of mine, while I was preparing, he shared this quote from Matt Chandler yesterday. I was like, yo, this is so spot on for this sermon as well. You can't expect God to be your source of peace if the world is your source of satisfaction. Now, once or twice in the last year, there's one or two things that happened or almost happened where I didn't realize how I was walking in the peace of God until this thing happened and I lost the peace of God. I was like, I don't want to lose that. It's so precious to have the peace of God and to walk in it. We can't expect that peace if the world is our source of satisfaction. Matthew 6:33, all of us know the scripture so well. But let it not be theoretical for us. Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And all these things, whether it's joy, whether it's peace, whether it's a house or food or clothes, as Matthew 6 talks about, all these things shall be added unto you. But we need to put first things first and be practical about it. Whether it's closing your door, getting into the Word, whether it is getting in the car and going to a small group, say, God, I'm not maybe feeling like it tonight or this morning, but I want to be practical about seeking your kingdom first. And this is how I want to seek your kingdom. We're talking about our hearts and how God longs for our hearts and the things that bind or blind our hearts. We've spoken about idols and you'll know which is maybe that idol in your life. But sometimes there are veils. And sometimes it's the enemy. Something is just a spiritual something that the enemy, a strategy that he's attempting to use on us. Sometimes it's religion. And we see that in 2 Corinthians 4, verse 3 to 4. But even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. So maybe we haven't sort of backslid a little bit, or just went a little bit off course after idols. Maybe the enemy has got a plot against us, trying to veil our hearts that we might not see. And we're going to look at how we go beyond that. Or maybe it's not the enemy. Maybe we've fallen into the false comfort of religion. Matthew 27 is 50 to 51. And Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. Then behold, the veil of the temple. So there's a veil that the enemy sometimes wants to pull over our hearts in the spirit. Sometimes it's the veil of the temple to me resembles religion. And religion is can be coming to church, where we just, okay, it's the thing that I'm going to do. Then behold, the veil of the temple, when he yielded up his spirit, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth quaked, and the rocks were split. God longs for our hearts, and Jesus Christ didn't come to earth and go to the cross for us to remain blind and slaving away at the distance. Church, our coming together must be so much more than just a well-run organization. In Revelations 2, verse 2 to 4, we see a very well-run organization. I know your works, your labor, your patience, and that you cannot bear those who are evil, and you have tested those who say that they are apostles and are not, and have found them liars, and you have persevered and have patience, and have labored for my name's sake, and have not become weary. Nevertheless, I have this against you, that you have left your first love. Our relationship with God, or our faith, must be much more than just a tick box. Conscience-driven, or maybe a prosperity vending machine type of religion. Of rules and rewards. We've been called to relationship. And we were talking at the beginning, we were talking about longing for life. And what is that life? John 17, verse 3, and this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. If we long to know God in reality, don't wait in some room for a goosebump experience. Expect him at an unexpected angle, very close to home, and see him appear in emails, in a car crash, in a meeting, in a social gathering. To know him is to know him between marrow and bone is not always the most comfortable space. And as I was preparing for the sermon, I was just thinking also about, you know, I realized, listen, I need to really press in just in the spirit again. And I was, because I realized my vacation hadn't solved my spiritual drought. And I was thinking about Exodus 33, where Moses, where it talks about how Moses knew God as a friend, and how God spoke to him as a friend, and how he said, Lord, that God said that my presence will go with you. And Moses said, I don't want to go anywhere without your presence. And Moses said, Lord, I want to see your glory. And God said, no man can see me and live. And I always think about that. Lord, I want to see you. But Lord, not in a way that I'm going to die, please. You know, but I was thinking about how God said Okay, hide in this little crevice or in this part of the rock, and I will pass by you. And if I'm talking about one, I imagine myself being, you know, knowing God. Like I said, sometimes it's not always the most comfortable space, but it's a place where we can be filled with awe and wonder again when He opens our eyes. And I'm just thinking, imagine I was Moses and God moved by. I'm like, don't you long for that? Eternal life is to know God. So I've said quite a few tough things so far this morning, and you might be asking, Johannes, remember that aquifer you were talking about, that water source deep down? When are we going to start hitting that this morning? How do I get from idols? How do I walk beyond the veils that the enemy maybe wants to draw over me in the spirit, or the veil that I've allowed in my own life through starting to walk in a cold-hearted religion? How can I know God again as my life, as my all-satisfying first love, as we read in Revelation, that church that was so well organized but had lost its awe and its wonder and its first love for God? And it's not necessarily fasting from a whole lot of things now, working, trying harder, but maybe more just focusing, just readjusting our focus. And if you think about a magnifying glass, how when you start focusing on something, and on a paper, as a little boy, you often do that, and the paper catches light. And it's just our hearts this morning that it's not necessary that we must fast from all those other things that we also long for and need for in life, but it's just coming and saying, God, help me to refocus on you and ignite my heart. Martin Fryer, some of you guys will know him, but he once shared this quote. I don't know where he got it from, but it's stuck with me. Attention leads to affection. Johannes, how can I get rid of this veil and shake off my idols? And how can I do it? Just let's refocus our attention, because attention leads to affection. And as I was pondering on the sermon during the week, I was having lunch and I was sitting there and I saw a little mossy. I don't know what's a mossy in English again. A little bird, a mossy, like Viet mossy. But I was sitting there looking at this little bird, and I was thinking about ornithology. Who can tell me what's ornithology? Ornithology is the study and the science of birds, okay? And if you know a bird watcher, it's people that love watching birds, and it's almost like a game. You've got this book, and you look at the bird, and it's like, yes, it's that one, okay? But if you've been around bird watchers, they start needing to look at the book, and then they look at the bird, and then they realize, okay, it's that bird. Later on, they can look at the bird without the book, and they'll tell you, oh, that's a mossy. Later on, and I've had friends and family, and they'll go like, oh, that's a mossy. They don't see the bird anymore. They hear it and recognize it. And isn't that how we want to live with God? Attention leads to affection. And those keen bird watchers, they only get to that place by spending time in the book. Sounds familiar, eh? And not just being in the book, but going out and identifying those birds out in nature. Practical. Attention leads to affection. So how can I know God again if I've maybe run dry, if my heart has become hardened, if I've lost my awe, my wonder? Know God by humbly asking. There's an artist and also a writer, Sean Coleman from New Zealand. He's got this page on Instagram called Commoner's Communion, where he just shares prayers that the Lord, that, you know, prayers that he jots them down. And in this time where I was going through this, where I also realized, okay, I need to just fix my attention again. And this prayer really struck me. Your spirit touched me and I realized how little I see. And then he went on and said, if you ask him, he will come and you will never settle for less again. Your spirit touched me and now I see how little I see. I can relate with that. And it's not just him that shares that truth and that promise that as we ask him, he will come. We see it throughout Scripture. Matthew 7, you ask, shall receive. You seeks will find. You knocks, it will be open. James 4, verse 6 to 8. He gives more grace. Therefore, he says, and that we read from James earlier as well, where it's, James spoke about the condition of our hearts, where we have fallen into spiritual adultery. And he says, but he gives more grace. Therefore, he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. This promise, draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Know God by humbly asking. Know God by living faith. We read from Hebrews 4 earlier. Therefore, since a promise remains of entering his rest, let us fear lest any of you seem to have come short of it. For indeed the gospel was preached to us as well as to them, but the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith. So, we can know God by humbly asking him. And then we must believe that he will come. We must believe what he promises in his word. What are you, where are you stepping out of the boat in your life at the moment? Maybe some of those prayers that you've prayed for a while ago and you just haven't seen anything happen and you've stopped praying then. Where do you need to step out in faith again? Because dead religion isn't something that requires faith. Know God by walking and sowing in the Spirit. We, Galatians 5, I'm going to fast forward a little bit here. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. He talks about this battle between the flesh and the Spirit, which I can really relate with. I want to do this thing now. I just want to do woodworking all the way, but I realize, my spirit is dry. So I'm going to deny my flesh and actually go and spend time now. It feels fake, but it's just because your flesh is so real, pulling you in a different direction. But just spending time in your hobbies is not going to satisfy my soul. It's not going to feed my spirit. So I go in this direction to sow in the Spirit. For he who sows to the flesh will of the flesh reap corruption, but he who sows in the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. So how can I know God? Humbly asking, believe that he will show himself to you, and then and sow in the Spirit. Sometimes you need to deny your flesh, and I know I said it's not, we don't need to fast of everything, but sometimes it's part of refocusing that magnifying glass is stepping out and sowing in the Spirit. So I'm going to end off with the promises that God has for us from his word. I'll also fast forward a little bit here. In Hebrews 8, we said to know God is life. We said we, deep down, we're actually longing for life. And life is to know him. And Hebrews 8 is just an awesome promise. Basically, it says that each and every one of us can know God. That is the promise of the new covenant. It's not just the kings and the priests and the prophets in the Old Testament. Each and every one of us sitting here today, not just the worship leader or the intercession leader or the pastor or the guy on YouTube with the how many million views sermon that can know God. You and I can know God. That veil that I spoke about in Corinthians, that the enemy tries to pull over us, if you believe this, if you think this morning that you can't know God, that is the kind of veil that I'm talking about. That veil of a lie that he pulls over you. No. Johannes, I can't hear his voice. The word isn't alive to me. Take this truth this morning. You can know God. That is a promise this morning. Another promise this morning is that his Spirit will satisfy us. That's where we started out this morning. But he promises us that he will satisfy our spirit. I'm going to read this whole portion because it would just so describe this picture that I also saw of us drilling in the dry desert place. They wandered, Psalm 107, they wandered in the wilderness in a desolate way. They found no city to dwell in, a place of rest. Hungry and thirsty, their soul fainted in them. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them out of their distresses. Let's cry out to the Lord. And he led them forth by the right way, that they might go to a city for a dwelling place. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness, for his wonderful works to the children of men. Like the English Americans say, and here comes the kicker. For he satisfies the longing soul. How beautiful. These people who were wandering around in a wilderness as they cried out to God. He satisfies the longing soul and fills the hungry soul with goodness. He turns a wilderness into pools of water and dry land into water springs. Reminds me of John 7, verse 37 to 9. In our hearts, if our heart is a dry land this morning, He and He alone can satisfy our longing soul. And even in that dry, hardened heart of you this morning, He can bring pools of water and springs of water. He promised us rest. Where it's maybe halfway through the year and you feel overwhelmed and tired, He promises us. Where there was a warning in Hebrews 4, there's always also the promise that as we come with belief and obedience. Verse 3 says in Hebrews 4, we who have believed do enter that rest. That's a promise for us this morning. We can enter that rest. We don't need to go in limp mode or autopilot for the rest of the year. We can enter His rest. And from that place, walk in His strength. Isaiah 40, and I'm finishing with this scripture. God neither faints nor is He weary. Verse 30 to 31. Even the youths shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. All of us, each and every one of us, can know God. He will satisfy our souls. He will give us rest. And He will strengthen us. As we come and humbly ask, as we come by faith, and as we walk in the Spirit. Amen. So I'm going to ask Caroline if she's still around, just to come and minister a song to us. And this morning, I want us as individuals, just there where we are at, I've put up two scriptures there for us, just as personal consecration prayer this morning. I I want us just to keep those last two scriptures up there. And I want us to respond to this word this morning, which I'm trusting is a word in season for us. And I want you to take these two scriptures, and just as we are sitting, as Rulene is ministering the song to us, just quietly pray through these two scriptures, or read through these two scriptures as prayers unto God, as we respond to Him. Just between you and the Lord. And if there's anyone that's you're really at a desperate place and you're like, Johannes, I can't even pray these prayers. I really need someone to pray with me. I'll gladly pray with you in the front, or you can ask a leader to pray with you as well, your small group facilitator. So don't feel we're not here for you. If you need prayer, please, we'll pray with you. But otherwise, just there where you're at, in business with the Lord, and let's respond to this one. Amen.